You know, it was back in 1973 when Diane Rehm, who was looking for something to expand her horizons, anticipating the day her two kids would be out of the house, heard of a possible volunteer opportunity at a radio station on the campus of American University. She walked through the doors of WAMU and offered her services for a program then called The Home Show. 6 years later, in 1979, she took over as the host of WAMU's morning talk show, which was subsequently renamed The Diane Rehm Show. And the rest, as they say, is history. As many of you who've been devoted listeners know, Diane's probing interviews and informative discussions have offered insightful perspectives on many, many issues. And her program, distributed by NPR, is currently broadcast on nearly 200 stations and on satellite radio across the country, and overseas, too, by the Armed Forces Network. Over the years, Diane has let us in periodically on her life and her celebrated career through several memoirs, including Finding My Voice, A Life with Maxie, that's her dog, and with her husband, John, Toward Commitment. In her new book, On My Own, she provides a deeply moving and very revealing account of the final stages of John's life as he succumbed to Parkinson's disease, and her own efforts since he passed away nearly 2 years ago to reconstruct her life. With much evident thought and care, she reflects on loneliness, loss, grief, guilt, worry, aging, and renewal. A review in Publishers Weekly said the book, quote, speaks powerfully to those who have lost a loved one and found the strength to carry on. And a USA Today reviewer wrote that Diane, quote, doesn't have all the answers, nor does she pretend to. What she does have, as always, is a flurry of important questions, perfectly considered and potently posed. Now, Diane will be in conversation here this evening with Deborah Tannen, who also, I'm sure, is well known to many of you. She's an accomplished professor of linguistics at Georgetown University and a renowned authority on communication, especially communication between men and women. She's written nearly two dozen books, many of them academic works, but also several aimed at general audiences that have made the bestseller charts. Among them, You Just Don't Understand, Talking from 9 to 5, You Were Always Mom's Favorite, And You're Wearing That. I just love those titles. So ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming Diane Rehm and Deborah Tannen.
No surprise to see so many of you here.
I just turned this microphone on. I think we need to pot it down a bit. Okay. Is that better? Can you all hear? Okay.
I thought I did that by holding it too close.
No, you didn't. I did it.
Wonderful to see you all, and what a thrill that I get to interview Diane after having been interviewed by Diane for pretty much all my books, and such a thrill to talk about this amazing book. Yeah. It is so beautiful, it is so moving. But I want to say too, I feel that in a way you discovered me, because you had me on your show before any of my books were published. The show was Kaleidoscope. And you had seen a little thing I had written in the Baltimore Sun about Geraldine Ferraro, and the double bind that women in public life face. And I've been saying it nonstop since.
And look what's
most
happening
recently
today.
About Hillary Clinton.
Exactly.
But you picked that up back then. And then another, just a little tiny tidbit, You Just Don't Understand was not an immediate bestseller. I was not, you know, recognized name at that point. It came out in May, and it hit the bestseller list in August, so it was gradual. But when I was on your show in May, you held up that book and you said, I think you have a bestseller on your hands. And I thought, she's dreaming. But I think you have foresight.
Oh,
anyway,
thank you.
So and of course now we've become friends and it's
indeed
a treat for me to be here.
Dear friends.
So this book is so beautiful. And as you already heard, it is about your life after the death of your husband, about all the thoughts that that raised. But it also, I think, is very much a tribute to John Rehm.
Absolutely.
And you present him so movingly and so beautifully in the book, and a tribute to your marriage, which was a creation that you really both did together. So could you just tell us how you met John Rehm?
Oh, boy.
And came to marry him?
Oh, boy. John Rehm was an attorney at the Department of State. He was involved in matters of international trade. I was a secretary. And he happened to be doing some work for my boss, who was also involved in international trade. And the first time John Rehm walked into our office, I had on my desk, and I recall this because John always reminded me, three books. The Brothers Karamazov, The Essays of Alfred North Whitehead, and of Human Bondage by Somerset Maugham.
Not your average secretary's reading.
Not your average secretary's reading. And John was very observant and began asking questions about why I had chosen these books, why I was reading them. The fact of the matter was I had never and have never been to college. And there I was in the atmosphere of this highly intellectual Department of State, and somehow I felt, if I can educate myself, if I can do the kind of reading I imagine all these brilliant people are doing, maybe I can learn something. Well, what I learned was that John was the pitcher for the men's softball team, and I was the second base person for the women's softball team. So we got to talking about baseball, and we made a bet that year on the World Series. And I won. And so John Rehm took me out to dinner, and that was our beginning.
I love that story. So in you had a lot of things in common, like baseball.
Right.
And there were also a lot of differences.
Totally.
Background.
Yeah.
Religion, many other things.
Yeah.
Can you talk a little bit about some of those differences and similarities and how that affected
John
religion?
Came from a very, a family very, very focused on education and intellectual matters. And after I've said that, I'll tell you his dad was sports editor of the Paris Herald Trib. His mother was a fashion model, a runway model in Paris. She had escaped her Philadelphia, very proper home upbringing, went to Paris, and that's where she and Pop met. So John Rehm, Scoop, he became Scoop because there were three other guys whose wives in the newsroom were pregnant at the same time my mother-in-law was, And he was the only boy born, so he became the scoop. I mean, really. So they stayed in Paris for the first 6 years. He came here to this country speaking no English. Pop saw the war coming, and that's why they came back. And lived in Lynbrook for a while in New York, and then Pop went back to the war for USIA. This is 45 or so. And John and his mother moved into Manhattan. He went on scholarship to Friends Seminary, to Harvard University, to Columbia Law School. And I did not go to college. So he had no religious background. His mother and father did not want to, quote, burden him with a religious orientation. I was baptized in the Syrian Orthodox Church because my mother and father, both born in Mersin, Turkey, father's family went to Beirut, mother's family went to Alexandria, Egypt. Somehow we got called Syrian Orthodox, and that's where I was baptized.
And so very different backgrounds.
Very different.
But you began the marriage in a very traditional mold.
Totally.
And, yeah. And I love the image, just sort of captures that. He actually carried you over the threshold.
He did, indeed. He did, indeed.
But it was traditional, and you assumed that and didn't question it. He would do the finances. You would take care of the home, the children. He was teacher to your pupil.
Totally teacher to me, the pupil. And totally in charge of all finances. I did not even have a checkbook. Until one Christmas, I went out to buy the pajamas that he wanted. The pajamas. And I looked and looked and looked. And finally, for those of you who've been around for years, I found them at the old Raleigh's store. Pulled out my credit card, and they said, oh, we don't take that anymore. I had to go all the way back home because John kept a desk checkbook and wrote his checks at his desk. Write a check, take the check back, finally got the pajamas, went home that night and said, I am opening a checking account of my own, which John Rehm didn't like very much.
That's an understatement.
That's an understatement. He did not speak to me for a while.
You write even something like 2 weeks.
Two weeks.
Yeah.
2 weeks.
So
maybe three.
So I have so many questions to follow up on that. So you go from a marriage of that sort, but you did get your own checkbook. And over the years, it evolved. And you as individuals and the marriage evolved in enormous ways over the 54 years that you were together. So you went to being partners, and really gradually, as then he retired, you
continued.
First volunteer, but then your career goes up and up and up. And then, of course, when he gets Parkinson's, the balance shifts even more. So several questions about that. How do you think, what do you think it was about you as an individual and John as an individual that you were able to make that transition? And, you know, was that first checkbook fight, which you won? You got your checkbook, right?
You bet.
Yeah. And so part of me wants to ask, what was it about you that were able to stand your ground?
Stubborn. And diligent and careful. I have never not balanced my checkbook in all these years. I mean, it's something very important to me. And I think that what was clear was that John loved his government work. He loved the 13 years he practiced law in the government. When he went into private practice after Nixon was elected, he did not enjoy the law as much. He did not enjoy saving money for corporations. He enjoyed being a government representative. He became the first legal counsel under Governor Christian Herter to be the U.S. Special Trade Representative. John created that office with his legal work and then became the first legal advisor there. His career went up and up and up, and we had great times during that period, wonderful social times, being invited to places, and he loved that because it was all his work oriented. When he left government and then went into private practice, I think that was a lot harder for him because as something of a Quaker, within him, he did not like the idea of making a lot of money. And money was what the practice of law was about. When he finally retired at age 70, and I begged him not to, I thought it was too early. I begged him not to, but he said, I've had enough. So he planned his retirement for 5 years ahead of time. He took a year's course at the Freer and Sackler to become a docent. Mighty, mighty attentive courses. He became a reader for the blind and dyslexic, and he also became a volunteer for hospice. Now, in the meantime, he had had a religious conversion experience at the Church of the Doubting Thomas in New York. This man who tolerated my going to church with the children. We were in some real difficulty, Deborah, real, real difficulty. And I went away with a friend. He went to New York to see his mother. He was walking down Fifth Avenue and simply stopped in the church of St. Thomas on Fifth Avenue. And all of a sudden, as he wrote in his own book, Onward Journey, he said he felt he was caught by Christ. And he spent, after he came home, he sobbed to me on the telephone. He spent the next 10 years earning a master's in religious in theological studies from Wesley University. So this man was so special, such an incredible student and man of words, man of music, man of literature. He was everything.
It's a beautiful story. I feel you were so special and beautiful together. And his having that conversion, it feels like it had to do with you. you described it, that faith was important to you, it was not to him. And it seems one more way that you started out so far apart and came so close. And the image of someone who didn't talk to you for 3 weeks because you just wanted a checkbook.
Right.
Eventually became one of the, a tremendous supporter of you your career.
Oh my gosh.
I guess not to totally belabor this, but you do it to the people on your show, so.
She's got me.
What was it about each of you that you were able to evolve so much and come such a long distance?
I think the basic, the fundamental thing we had was respect for each other. Even through all the difficulties, through all the domestic travails, through all the, we weren't meant for each other, you ought to go your way, I ought to go my way, through all of that. Nevertheless, there was that fundamental, it was almost adoration. I mean, I would walk into the room and he would just sort of really melt. And I would sometimes, we had a large home in Westmoreland Hills, and sometimes I'd be waiting out on the front stoop for him. And he had this wonderful lumbering walk. It was so graceful. And I'd be sitting there on the stoop just waiting for him. And my friend across the street told me that sometimes she'd look out the window and feel jealous when we hugged and kissed each other. So there was something there that was so strong, and yet two of us, such strong personalities, each of us, you know, I mean, John did his thing and I did my thing and he was supporting me, except he was saying, gee, I wish you were still ironing my shirt. He did. He would say that, because I ironed so beautifully, really.
Did he learn to iron?
No, he never learned to iron. We then had to send the shirts out.
One of the most, a tremendous gift that you give to your readers in all your books, and certainly in this one too, you write so movingly about the beautiful parts of this friendship and relationship, but you don't idealize it.
No.
And you do talk about the difficult times, the struggles.
Absolutely.
So let me switch to ask something else that I know a lot.
And you know why I do that? Because I don't believe there are any perfect marriages. I think that even ours, which lasted 54 years, and on the surface, people saw as wonderful. Even our pediatrician, when the kids were, I don't know, verging on teenage years, I walked into his office one day and he said, how do you and John do it? Well, if he had only been behind the doors, he would have seen it was not perfect. And that's why I wanted to write about those tough times, because there aren't any perfect marriages. We all compromise, we all struggle, and some of us, as my friend E.J. Mudd once said, some of us last it out. Some of us last it out. And John and I did, thank God.
And I will ask you to read a bit where you talk a bit about that, but I want to ask you about one other thing first that I haven't heard discussed that much in other interviews you've done. One of the most moving scenes that you write about was a service that you attended for family and friends of people who had donated their bodies to the George Washington University Medical School. And it's very much like so much of what you write. It's a beautiful about connection and about, and so straightforward and honest about death. But could you just say a little bit about that decision that you both made to donate your bodies to medical science?
Don't donate your body to GW because they lost bodies. And they have since shut down the program. You probably have read about that. But I will donate my body elsewhere. They called me 3 days before the announcement came out in the Washington Post. They shut down the program. The reason John and I donated our bodies, I have still mine on record, is that when our daughter Jenny went to Boston University Medical School, they did not have sufficient cadavers to work on. The students had to share. I know how grisly it may sound, but John and I thought that was beautiful, that, you know, your body could be used to help young students find their way through medical school.
And allow them to then help
others.
People.
Exactly. So that year after John died, there was this wonderful service at George Washington University where each of the students, first year students moving on to second year, talked about how much those cadavers had meant to them and how personally they began to relate to them. Jenny Rehm said they named theirs Herc because he was such a big, muscular guy, and they talked to him all the time. You know, and so John and I both thought what a wonderful gift that would be to medicine. I don't want somebody coming in and taking my brain or my liver before I'm dead or whatever. You know, I worry about that because I know the conditions under which one donates an organ, so I won't go there any further. But donating a body seemed to me just lovely. But each of those students in poetry, in dance, in music, in literature, expressed what that donation meant.
Your description of that is so moving. I think it's a scene that most of us are simply not aware of, that that could exist. And it just reminded me of so much about you, the recognition of the human connection behind the generous move.
Thank you.
So maybe I'll ask you to read a couple pages.
Okay.
Ignore my highlights. Maybe these two pages going to just to the top of there.
Okay. So I am asking myself questions. The chapter is titled Guilt, Guilt, Guilt. Looking back, I ask myself whether I would have acted differently had our marriage been a more fully satisfying one. We had struggled through years of therapy, both individually and together, many times on the verge of divorce, only to realize, and really finally to accept, how different we were as human beings. Might we, or I, have made a different decision regarding assisted living? Might I have moved heaven and earth to keep him with me take care of him, no matter what the sacrifice. When I look back on our many years together, filled with both times of joy and years of hostility, the endless periods of silence, the physical and emotional distance between us, I realize it was almost inevitable that it had come to this. In matters of companionship, John and I were total opposites. He grew up as an only child, completely doted on by his mother, playing alone as a toddler, learning to cope with parents who themselves had an extremely difficult relationship and who lived for most of their married life apart. John often said he'd prefer to have lunch with the New Yorker rather than any human being he knew, and I realized that that included me.
It captures so much of this book that you are so open and honest about the conflicting feelings that you went through, and I'm sure anybody goes through
in
facing a loss like that. Just this kind of quick question. You're the family that you grew up in. I know some of us come from families where everything is spoken, and others from families in which everything is secret, and I guess there's everything in between. Was there something in your family background that led you to be so generous and open with your life, your emotions, and saying things that everybody feels and experiences, but most people don't talk about?
My mother and father never talked about anything in front of us. Never. If I never in all my years, my mother and father both died when I was 19. She died first of, we think, liver cancer. She was 49. He died 11 months later of a broken heart. He was 62. I never in my entire life saw them exchange a harsh word. Now, that doesn't mean they didn't do it, but never in front of us. I can remember her wanting to buy a new rug for the living room, and it was after I had begun working at the DC Highway Department, calling the roadway operators when there were potholes in the street. I was working for the director of DC Highways, and he had me get on this two-way radio. I mean, that was my first experience. But I, in all those years, if they ever fought, I never saw it. So here were John and I just going at it like that a lot. And it was because, I think, each of us had such extraordinarily different expectations. John really felt that silence and being alone was like a drink of fresh water. And my love was companionship and sharing. And I had many friends and brought them into the household. And John never once, I take that back, a year before Malcolm Brown, the Pulitzer Prize winning reporter for the New York Times, who was in Vietnam, he and John were classmates at Friends Seminary in New York. And a year before Malcolm, who also had Parkinson's, died, John called Malcolm. John Rehm never picked up the phone to call a single friend. And that was such a breakthrough. Such a breakthrough. Whereas, as you know, I was on the telephone every single day with my dearest beloved friend, the late Bishop Jane Dixon. I call her my beloved friend. She died on Christmas Day, totally unexpectedly, 1 month after John Rehm went into assisted living, which truly broke my heart. Truly broke my heart.
You spoke to her every day for 45 years.
Every day. And John Rehm would say, what do you guys talk about? And Jane's husband would say, what do you guys talk about? But they would both sit there and listen to the conversation. And every now and then, Dixie would hear something Jane would say, and he'd add to it. And John Rehm would do the same thing. So there was a yearning there, but not the ability to connect the way we did.
But yeah, so that balance between talk, which of course is your life, and silence, that was constantly the balance.
Constantly, and there wasn't a balance. There wasn't.
I shouldn't say the balance, I should say the struggle.
The struggle, absolutely. And when we had our difficulties, John would retreat into silence, and it drove me nuts.
And which he knew it would. He knew it would drive you nuts.
Of course. And he confessed about a month before he died. He said, I have a confession to make to you. He said, I deliberately, emotionally abused you. And I was just stunned to hear those words come out of his mouth. And it really took me aback. And I almost left the room, but I didn't. I said to him, you know, why do you think you did that? And he said, I don't know. And I have a theory that it was because he never confronted his mother with what he was feeling about her controlling nature. And she interfered in our marriage in such a way that I was totally relieved and saddened when she died, but relieved. And he could finally talk about his mother after she died. But to have him confess that to me was both shocking and freeing.
And generous in a way.
And generous, absolutely. He knew he was dying, and he needed to get that off his chest.
I have one last question, and then we'll open it up. I'm sure there are lots of questions.
You never know.
Yeah. I think there's going to be a lot. Because Diane is not signing books, we'll go a little bit longer than the usual hour, maybe an hour and 10 minutes.
Sure.
Something like that.
Because I signed, how many did I sign?
Several hundred.
Good. Okay.
So if there, people want it, we'll have it.
Yeah.
I was very struck by your description, and all, as I said, all your description, your account of what it's like this year after a tragic loss like that. You describe after the first Christmas without John and the relief of having gotten through that, But one aspect of it was really striking. The relief that you would no longer have to hear people's condolences. That people would say, I know how hard this is for you, which of course you appreciated because you knew it was out of kindness. But by saying that, they then remind you and make it harder. I know all of us, especially in this country where we are given so few rituals that we know are the right things to say at a time like this. What Americans tend to say is there's nothing to say at a time like this because they don't know what to say. But we all struggle, I think, with trying to decide, should we speak or not? Because if you say something, you're going to bring up a painful thing, maybe make people feel worse. If you don't, they may think you don't care.
I know.
So my last question is, having gone through this, would you speak any differently to people who have suffered a loss? And is there any suggestion or advice you could give to people, all of us who are struggling with that?
I think the only thing, Deborah, I say to people, and I write notes, is I'm so sorry for your loss. And
that's just about it.
And stop there. Yeah. And if that person wants to engage, that's fine. But there's one more thing I'd like to bring up before we open the phones here.
Take your questions,
guys. And that is that I want to, by virtue of this book, urge each and every one of us to become less death averse, to begin the conversation in your own homes, to not be frightened to talk about what it is you want at the end of your life. John Rehm knew he did not wish to fall any further into degradation. He could no longer feed himself. He could no longer stand. He could no longer walk from bed to bathroom. He had to have 24-hour caregiving. He said, enough. I am ready to die. And our daughter, the doctor, was on the phone from Boston. And she said, but Dad, we can keep you comfortable. And he said, I don't want comfort. I am ready to die. And the doctor said to him, there is nothing legally, morally, ethically that I, as a physician in Maryland, can do for you. But what you can do for yourself is to stop eating, taking medication, and drinking water. You all probably know that without food, you can live for a fairly long time, 45, 50, 60 days. But without water, the organs begin to break down quickly. And John was ready to die. I think so many of us are death averse that we do not want to talk either with our parents or with our children about what it is we want. Now, there are many among you, I'm sure, who would say, I want palliative care to keep me going as long as I can. And I say to you, absolutely, that's what you should have. And there are others among you who would say, I will go when God wants me to go. And I totally support that view as well. I would say for myself and myself only, I want to go when I no longer feel my life is worth living. Jerry Brown, in his signing statement for the right to die, death with dignity in California, the last paragraph of his signing statement, which I will paraphrase, he said, "I don't know what I will want when the time comes. What I do know is that I would not wish to have someone else make that decision for me." And that is how I feel, and that is the work I will concentrate on after I step away from the microphone at the end of the year. I'm sorry to take that from you.
I'm so glad that you, that was one of the questions that I was going to ask, which we didn't have time to get to. Just one last, just kind of building on what you said and taking your own words. One of the most beautiful things you said in the book, explaining that, that because John had to take this slow path, gradual path to death, it robbed you both of the what would have been a very intimate experience of sharing that death together.
That very last night, I had the feeling he was going to die. So I stayed at the assisted living facility on two chairs, trying to sleep with Maxie on my stomach. I couldn't sleep. And at 2 a.m., I had my iPad with me. I just got up and started writing what I was seeing, writing what I was thinking, and writing what I was feeling. And that was really the beginning of the book. And I'm so glad I was there that night. But when his caregiver arrived at 7:30 in the morning, I said, "I'm going to run home, feed Maxie, take a shower, and come back." As soon as I got home, the caregiver called and said, "Come back quickly. He's going." And I got there 20 minutes too late. Now, many, many caregivers will tell you that those who are dying wait until the loved one leaves. I wish I had stayed. How I feel. Thank you, Deborah.
And thank you so much. So we will open the floor to questions, your comments. We do have microphones. There is one there. Where's the other one?
And there's one there. Absolutely. Right there. Good.
Hello.
Hello.
I have listened to your program since it began.
Thank you.
And I cannot tell you how much it has meant to me.
I'm so glad.
Your wisdom and clarity are amazing. What I wanted to tell you was about my mother, who, like myself, had celiac disease, but it wasn't, at that time, understood at all. She never absorbed calcium, and so by the time she was in her 50s, 40% of her spine was fractured.
Oh, my.
And this was back in the days where the idea of giving people painkillers was twisted up into addiction. And so she never really got pain relief. And she was an amazing, amazing woman. When we lived in Rome, she came on her last trip to visit us. And she said to me, I want you, because in Italy they don't have the same restriction on prescriptions because the pharmacist writes them, not necessarily the doctor. And she said, if you can get me so many sleeping pills of this kind, I would appreciate it because I know I can't take this pain forever. And I went and I did it because I thought this is her decision, this is her exit, her choice, her dignity. And in the end, what struck me so was that she didn't use it. I think it gave her the choice.
Exactly.
And that was the most important thing of all. And I think by not giving people choice, we do remove from the individual the dignity that each one of us should have.
Thank you so much for that. Let me tell you that Oregon, which became the first state to pass a death with dignity law, of those who have been deemed eligible for the medication, only 3/4 have actually used the medication. In other words, the power is granted, and once the power is granted, one may say, you know, maybe I can survive for a bit longer. Maybe I'm not ready. I just woke up this morning and saw flowers. Maybe I'd like to stay around a bit more. So it's very interesting. Thank you.
Well, I'd like to join with everybody in this room, I think, and say how much I've enjoyed your shows.
Thank
and
you.
Admired you, and particularly admired your story, showing that you don't have to go to college to become distinguished.
But you have to read Alfred North Whitehead's essay.
Right. Think I'd rather go to college.
Good repat.
One comment and then a question, because wonderful presentation, and it got me thinking a lot about my parents' marriage, which at least when we were home was very contentious. But my mother was more successful than you in one respect, because she once said that when they were first married and had a fight, and Dad gave her the silent treatment, and she let him know that that was not acceptable. And after that, it was all strictly fight it out. And so that probably wasn't so bad. And I think they were, and they went through something like that transition where mom was, dad was a doctor and mom was a housewife, and then later ran for office and was in the state legislature.
Good.
So I'm curious to know, you talked about this a little, but what sort of changes went through in your dynamics and the way your husband related to you as you became more and more successful, and he was sort of on a flat plane?
You know, he often said that we were sort of going in the opposite direction. He was 6 years older than I, and of course he had been in the workplace far longer than I. I was at home with our children for 14 years. So I didn't even begin as a volunteer until I was 37. And here he was already reaching real heights in his own career. I just think the timing was different, and when he saw me begin to succeed, he did nothing but rejoice, truly. He used to brag on me all the time. But then every now and then he'd say, but I still wish you'd iron my shirt. And it got to be a real joke between us. But every morning I would come to the breakfast table and John might say something about something he was reading, and David or Jenny would say, oh, Dad, she's already done a show on that. Which didn't help. But, you know, I think he really did accept and rejoice in my success. At the same time, I think as his own career began winding down, I think it got hard for him. And the last trip we were supposed to go on together, his back was hurting him so bad, he just sat me down the morning before we were supposed to leave and said, sweetheart, I just can't do it. And I think that was a broader admission than we knew.
Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, ma'am. Oh, sorry.
Yes, thank you so much for sharing so much of your experience, but I have a question for you. You talked about that he had a religious conversion and that your religion was important to you. When the decision was finally made and you are watching him die in front of your eyes, it's so terrible, in an inevitable process. At what point, I mean, I've got to believe that the conflict within you to say, wait a minute. I mean, you talk about wanting to shake him awake or, you know, one last word. What kept you going? I mean, besides the fact that you loved him so much and you respected his opinion, but there has to have been a piece of you that wanted to say, wait, this isn't fair to me.
Absolutely. And I write in the book that there were moments when I wanted to give him a little applesauce or put some water into his mouth, sneak it into his mouth, and say, come back. I couldn't. I respected his decision. If I had done that, it would have violated my promise to him to do for him what he wanted. It would not have been fair of me. I would not have wanted, if I had made that decision, I would have been furious.
Did you know when your last words were, in hindsight? I mean, did you have a sense? You obviously knew when he was going to pass out of his body. But did you have any sense that, you know, this was the end in terms of a real communication?
Oh, I stroked his arm every day. I was there with him for that last 10 days. I did not go to work. I stayed there with him, except at night, except on that last night when I did. I kept telling him how much I loved him. I kept holding, stroking his gorgeous hands. I fell in love with his hands before I fell in love with him. And I kept stroking them.
Thank you. Thank you for sharing that.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for everything that you've done. I especially appreciate your candor about marriage and just the ups and downs. And what would be your advice to a young married couple? You know, kind of the traditional question, like what would you do differently if you knew where
that's
you
a
would
good
end
question.
Up? What kind of advice would you have
for I them? Wish I had been more mature in my expectations of him, and I wish I could have understood sooner that his need for silence needed respect, and my need for relationship needed to be respected as well. And I wish we could have talked more openly about that, about our different needs. You know, we then subsequently wrote a book together called Toward Commitment. And we did that by each of us writing an essay on one of, I think, about 25 subjects. And then we went up to our farm where it was totally quiet and exchanged those essays and fought like hell. And recorded the argument, recorded the going back and forth on each of those essays, and I then transcribed them, and that's what you read in that book. So we tried very, very hard at that point in our marriage, and this was 2002, so not all that long ago, to really try to understand each other better. I don't think anybody ever truly understands another human being, but all we can do is try and think back. You've got that little child there. Good reason to try. Thank you.
Thank you, I appreciate that.
Thank you. That was lovely. Hi.
Hi. I'm Mike Morse, retired minister. Terribly, terribly fond of your work and of your love story.
Thank you.
Embraced with a mission, I guess. My wife died 2 months ago.
I'm so sorry.
Alzheimer's. And I am particularly intrigued with your reference in here to George and Trish Vredenburg.
Indeed.
And your friendship with them, and particularly with their interest and concern that somehow or another, Alzheimer's patients, before they reach the point where they are mentally incompetent, are able to sign directives, essentially giving authority to someone else to abide by their wishes. If
that's not going to do it.
I know that's not going to do it.
Not going to do it.
But I am, my own experience with my wife, which is a poignant one, I think, was that her mother died of Alzheimer's, as well as five of her mother's sisters.
Ooh.
So there was a real genetic, seemed to be
right.
A genetic link there.
Right.
And she pleaded with me back in the 90s, please don't let this happen to me. And of course, we found ourselves in this terrible circumstance where I was helpless to do anything, even when she would plead with me, please help me, please help me, please
help
me.
There was an article in the New York Times Magazine about a year ago about a man and his wife who faced exactly that situation. She, knowing that she was moving into Alzheimer's, and the two of them deciding when the time would come. And at 2 months before the time they had decided, he said to her, I think we need to move more quickly, because he saw her failing.
Yes.
drugs to carry that off are not easy to get a hold of.
I know, and I was taken with your program yesterday. George was on that program, and very hopeful in a sense that drugs are, we hope, going to be available soon.
Well, you're talking about drugs to cure, and yeah, I'm talking about drugs to finish my life.
Finish my
should
life.
Should I
yes.
find myself in that situation? And it's so tough.
I know it.
And I'm so sad for your loss. Gosh, so
hard. I am so appreciative for your help on this, on the broader issue. I think it's significant.
Thank you so
and I'm
much.
Deeply,
I
deeply
appreciate.
Grateful for what you're doing.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hello.
Do you want to take one more question or
sure.
two? It's 10
two.
And 3.
Two.
Okay, these will be the two.
I
these
can't
be the two last questions.
One there and one
oh,
there.
Oh, okay.
I can't think of a day without the Diane Rehm Show. And there's nobody I hear on radio or elsewhere that I would want to take over on a full-time basis. I like the idea of a series of different hosts of the Diane Rehm Show. What would you think of having the show continue to be called the Diane Rehm Show?
And I'm not there.
With right? Diane Rehm appearing once or twice a month, or when the spirit moves you, and have a series of different hosts take over every 2 or 3 days as now when you're away.
That's so kind of you. I think when I leave the microphone, I think the microphone will belong to others. And it will be time. I will be 80 years old in September, and it will be time for me to do something different and for those 2 hours of public radio real estate, which have been so intensely valuable, to go to someone else. But thank you so much.
You'll be missed.
Thank you. One last.
My question is about the...
You have spasmodic dysphonia.
No, I had laryngectomy.
I see. I'm so sorry.
As a physician, I watch an individual die in many times. And the way your husband chose to die was very painful and cruel.
I don't know that it was painful. It was painful to me to watch, but I don't know that it was painful.
I think it's a terrible way to die.
I do too.
And a heart on the patient and heart on the family.
Yes.
It's really inhumane. And there should be a better way for
of course, and Oregon, California, Washington, Vermont, and New Mexico have all decided that there is a better way. So, you know, if it comes to that, I go out to Oregon every 4 months to get an injection right there of Botox to keep my voice going. And if it comes to that, I'm going to establish residence there.
But how did you deal with it emotionally yourself, watching your husband die in a
painful way?
I
knew that that's what he wanted. There was nothing else to be done. I could, and the doctor had warned me from the moment we got there. He said, Diane, you are a publicly known person. Please do not do anything that you would and John would regret. I could do nothing. John was and is, in my mind, the most courageous man I've ever known. He did it for himself. Thank you.
Thank you.
There's one more question.
Hi, Diane.
Hi.
Connie and I, of course, have known you for many, many years. Just loved you, respected you, your whole family.
Your son was even with us.
I know, he's just, but anyway, I wanted to you to think about this from a different perspective because of me and my parents. My parents had a spectacular, loving relationship for many, many years.
Yeah.
And my father would do anything for my mother and vice
versa. Tell them who your dad was.
Shirley Povich. And he wrote for the Washington Post for a mere 75 years.
And Shirley Povich's grandson was my son, David Rehm's colleague at Landon School. And he went up to our farm with us and stayed for, we've had a long relationship.
Spectacular family you have.
Yeah.
Anyway.
Thank you.
My point is, my father and mother had this wonderful, wonderful, loving relationship. And there isn't anything they wouldn't do. In the end, my father lived for many years at the Colonnade, and he loved that apartment. And he said to me one day, we had a big house on Rittenhouse Street and a little house that from time to time we got, and we would have renters, or Connie's mother lived there. And finally he came to me one day and he said, I would like to move into your house, the little house, on one condition, that when Mother and I move in, that you never let Mother live anywhere else. What had happened was he had outlived his friends, and he used to visit them in nursing homes, and he hated the surroundings, he hated the situation, and he wanted someplace for Mother where she could be for the rest of her life, and she had Alzheimer's for the last 10 years.
Oh, boy.
And he wanted her there where someone would take care of him that she knew, where we were living next door. My wife was spectacular with her.
Yes.
And he said, if you don't, never move, Mother, I'll move there. And we did, and she lived there for many years, and it was like he had finally accomplished his purpose. About 4 months later, he died from a heart attack. But he had accomplished what he wanted. And my question is, his relationship with my mother has influenced me terrifically about living or taking your own life. And I can't imagine my father, and probably my mother, wanting the other to die before they came to a natural death. And so that has influenced me so much. And yet I struggle with the issue that you have. But I want other people, for sure, if they decide that time for them, their lives to end, to be able to do that. But I just want to let you know that I've been influenced by wonderful parents who love each other, unlike your situation, for instance. And I just think that it is overpowering to me in my approach about how our lives should end.
And this, I'm so glad you said this. It's so important because all of these factors influence our decisions. And all of these factors make a difference in how we make our choices. And you clearly have a fundamental center based on your family that guides you in your choice. And John had a different way.
Exactly.
And I will have a different way. But what I am asking us all to consider is that the choice should be ours.
Yes.
Thank you.
Absolutely. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. You were wonderful.